Yeah, so I was trying to figure out where to classify Beavis and Butthead under comedy or animation, because in animation I have Ninja Turtles, I had under action.
Hey, guys!
Oh, hey!
I'm here to return Heavyweight, a great movie with Ben Stiller, Kenan Thompson. It's a great one. We should review it.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think we're good. We're going to actually talk about the Ernest movies.
Oh, Ernest! I love Jim Varney. He's one of my favorite actors. Great comedy.
Listen, the fire marshal actually called James earlier. He said we can't have more than three people here, and we're over weight capacity, so I'm sorry, you can't.
Yeah. Oh, so the reviews are going down to three people because of the fire marshal code, not because I'm super obnoxious and we talk over each other and this works better for microphone placement and all that stuff?
There is no audio issue. It is just because of the fire marshal.
Yes, the fire marshal said no.
What are you talking about? I don't know what these microphones are. This is a off-the-cuff, fun conversation between friends.
So it's just the fire marshal. It's not the microphones.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
All right.
I'll see you later.
Dick.
But first, a message from our sponsor.
Come on, man. You got this.
I don't know, Tony, man. I've been playing this game for hours. I'm starting to crash.
I think I got just the thing. Drink now.
Maybe later. Right now I'm playing the game.
No, Kieran. Drink now. NowSense is the perfect drink for gamers. It's got vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. And it doesn't have the side effects that those other drinks have.
I don't know, Tony. I heard the taurine in those drinks is bad for you.
There's no taurine.
Well, caffeine makes me really restless.
There's no caffeine.
I'm trying to watch my calorie intake, Tony. Don't know if that's a good idea.
It's low in calories.
Well, where can I get NowSense?
Their website offers worldwide shipping. They also have a money-back guarantee. Drink now and get the crisp focus and advantage you need while gaming.
NowSense gives me what I need to game to the extreme.
So I'm very glad we're talking about an Ernest movie here. This is my favorite. Well, it's debatable. It's either this or Ernest Scared Stupid. But we're going to talk about Ernest Goes to Jail. And just in case you're not familiar with Ernest, Jim Varney was this character actor. In the 90s, he was in all these movies, in the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a TV show, Hey Vern. He got his start in commercials.
Vern, you've even got all your major networks all crystal clear. And Vern, you've even got your HBO Cinemax combo that you so jealously fond of.
It was a character he played in commercials, and then
it
ended up taking a life of its own, kind of like Max Headroom and a couple other characters kind of took a life of their own.
Yeah, and Vern was this unseen character who was basically the audience. He's always talking to the camera and saying, like, hey, Vern, you know. Ernest Goes to Jail, I think, was like, it may have been the pinnacle of just the comedy genius of Jim Varney. It's just
So Ernest is a janitor at a bank.
He aspires to be a bank clerk one day.
But so one day he gets jury duty.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, this is the perfect way to become this upstanding citizen. I'm going to go do jury duty.
He's happy about jury duty, whereas most people would not be happy.
Yeah. I have to say, I've never gotten called for jury duty. I have no idea why.
Oh, yeah. I have, but once. I never, I didn't actually have to go in, but you know they put you in that, like, waiting thing?
Yeah.
But anyway.
He does jury duty, and while he's doing jury duty, the guy who's on trial goes, hey, he looks exactly the same as our crime boss leader who is in prison.
Let's talk about this prison real quick, because there is this meanwhile, like, this is all happening, like, parallel to Ernest's life. Ernest is just living his regular life in his weird house with all his weird traps.
His gadgets and all that things.
Basically, it's like Pee-wee's Playhouse.
Pee-wee vibes.
Yeah. I used to always get Ernest and Pee-wee confused when I was a kid all the
because
time.
He has a house that's full of all those, like, contraptions and stuff where, like, you just look at the clip. You'll see. You know what I mean. Meanwhile, in prison, there's almost like this underground crime, like, crime network.
Yeah.
And the lead crime boss of this whole thing is this guy, Mr. Nash, who you only see in silhouette.
Yeah.
He's always, like, hidden in shadow of some kind.
Which is real obvious why they're doing it. I get it.
And then basically, after this guy who you're talking about in the trial notices, hey, he looks just like my crime boss, then you finally see Mr. Nash in the light for the first time, and it's Jim Varney.
It's Ernest with like an angry face and slicked hair.
So basically, Jim Varney is playing two characters in this film, Ernest and Mr. Nash. Now, Mr. Nash, the criminal, switches places with Ernest. So the whole idea...
Can I talk about that for a second?
Yes.
I need a lawyer or someone to explain to me. Is it possible to say, oh, hey, judge, I think the jury needs to see the crime scene. Can we move the trial to the crime scene, which is also a prison? I'm like, I don't think that's how it works at all, but that's their excuse to get him into the prison.
One of the major things about this film is that it makes no sense at all.
it's got a lot of like plot devices that just lead you into later, but that's the point.
We also haven't mentioned, I don't know how we got this far without mentioning it, Ernest gets electric magnet powers.
Okay, all right. So, meanwhile, while Ernest is working at the bank, there's this subplot developing where he has this this weird ability where whenever he gets electrocuted, well, first of all, the fact that he just gets electrocuted all the time by like habit.
Yeah, the floor polisher electrocutes him and...
He's immune to it. As a matter of fact, that movie behind you, Kieran, that one man-made monster, which is to the left of the Wolfman, starring Lon Chaney Jr., the actor of the Wolfman before he played the Wolfman. Yeah. This almost has the same plot. This is the same character. He plays Dynamo Dan, the electric man, who becomes immune to electricity. So Ernest has an immunity to electricity. Yeah. But the thing is, whenever he gets electrocuted, he gets magnetized.
Yeah.
So anything that's metal is attracted to him.
Yeah.
And I had a question, because after I saw how the magnet's growing after him, I was wondering if this movie was written by the Insane Clown Posse, because it has no idea how fucking magnets work. Yeah, because it's not just that the metal's attracted to him. It's like the filing cabinets are chasing them as if they come to life.
That's not
magnetism.
he goes into like the security deposits and everything.
Yeah.
And like the two of them start like rattling and they just smash him in the face.
Yeah, I love that scene.
And the thing is, like, I mean, those things are supposed to be secure, but then again, this movie is just, you have to throw reality out the window.
Yeah. So he gets thrown into jail.
Yeah.
And he doesn't even realize he's swapped with the prisoner yet. He thinks it's all jury.
He thinks that the entire time that he's still on jury duty. And he's talking, I love when he's like at the lunch table.
Yeah.
And he's just like, wow, look at this. Oh my God. It's the system. This is horrible. Wow, there's a lot more jurors than usual. And he has no idea. And I like the part where it's like everybody's standing up waiting to eat for the guy. And they hear him like eating. Like, and it's just him scraping against the tray. It's a clink, 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 clink. And he's just sitting there eating. And the guy's like, get up. Like, the entire time he has no idea he's in prison. He finally does realize it, though. And he has that whole like scene.
I'm in jail.
Yeah, I'm in jail.
Oh, no, I'm in jail.
So this jail is a multicolored jail of pink and blue. It's always pink and blue. And the uniforms of the police officers, they wear these like purple uniforms with these angular shoulders.
They look like M. Bison when you pick him with not the right color in like Super Street Fighter.
It looks like Batman Forever. It's like a Joel Schumacher like kind of weird thing. So this movie is just, it's not set in reality.
Like the two security guards. Like, they're in their own, like, little movie.
Yeah. You mean, like, the guys who run that independent home security? Yeah.
By the way, the fat guy I didn't find funny, that skinny old guy is so fucking funny. Just
Bobby?
He reminds me, our good friend Nathan
Barnett. I think he's Bobby. Yeah. Go ahead.
Our good friend Nathan Barnett did a series of videos where he's carrying around, like, a dead body, and he found, like, an old skinny guy, and it reminded me of that guy.
You know who they seem to be modeled after is Penn and Teller.
Because
the Bobby guy is silent. He doesn't say a word. He has a yard, which is a minefield.
It's a minefield!
And Ernest has to, like, walk. Ernest almost dies going to their house.
He could just walk on the sidewalk. And he's like, oh, let me go through the mine.
He hops across their lawn.
And he's doing
target practice in his living room.
At the front door.
And Ernest is dodging the bullets, like, in between
the fucking door.
And then the whole scene goes by. And then you realize he's been waiting for for a gingerbread man to pop up out of his toaster so he can shoot it. He's doing this thing with his head like this.
My favorite scene of the whole movie where Ernest is in court and he's listening to like the most horrific like crime being described, and it's like, you know, they're going around about this murder trial and he's biting a pen and he bites the whole top of it and the ink just pours into his mouth. So then he's trying to clean the ink the entire time, but he's just making it way worse and it's getting slimy and gross and everything. And they're describing how this guy murdered someone and the guy's defending it, but Ernest, they keep cutting Ernest and he's like trying like desperately to act like a normal person.
It's so gross. It's like so
can you imagine if this was a normal courtroom scene where, like, because already as it is, this scene exists to give you information. It's an exposition scene to give the audience information. There's this criminal who's on trial, and then he has this crime boss, and then you have Ernest just covered in ink, and he's distracting the whole scene away from
the whole piece of paper, and he's like chewing it loud and everything.
The judge is like, "Are you okay?" The judge would be like, "Get the fuck out of my court."
I love that when he's just like, fine, thank you. And he's just covered in ink all crazy looking. Like,
yeah, it's like everything he does, it makes it worse. Like, then he's chewing on that paper or whatever. Yeah. And like,
oh my God.
He wipes his face with it. Yeah. And he's trying to like get it. And he's going like this, like trying to make it like go away. And it's just getting all over him.
Oh my God.
Such a great scene. That scene I had to watch like 5 or 6 times. Like, I was laughing so hard throughout of it.
Not to mention, just totally random, he takes a bath in his washing machine.
Yeah. I'm like, what is he putting? Oh, he's putting himself in the washing.
That's right. Yeah, he's going on a date with Charlotte, who he works with. Well, kind of a date.
That's a great scene too. She's like, hey, I just want to talk. He's like, a date? She's like, no.
Yeah.
She's actually like the only character that's normal. Like, she's kind of like, she's sort of like
real extreme except for her.
Yeah.
And
like
the
when
boss.
He's having dinner with her and the lobster gets like attached to his face.
Yeah, all the because he touches a wire that also magnetizes him again.
Oh yeah.
So while he's eating, like he's touching things and like the silverware is coming up and he's like trying to be like normal and everything.
Yeah. You know what my favorite part of the date is when he's like trying to get ready and it, like on the rack it's nothing but denim vests. I'm like, how many times a week can a fucking guy wear a denim vest? Yeah. Am I right? It's ridiculous. It's the most unrealistic thing in the movie. Oh, hey, what's up, Kieran?
This criminal who is basically trying to make him act like his crime boss, Mr. Nash. He's like, no, you gotta talk the voice, you gotta do this, and he's like trying to get him to do it. So Ernest, there's this scene where Ernest is looking in a mirror and he's just trying to do the voice of Mr. Nash. Yeah. He goes into like James Cagney.
Yeah.
He goes into Humphrey Bogart. And then all of a sudden he starts doing Sylvester Stallone.
Hey, yo, Murdoch. You're the guy that shot my brother, right? And I'm the guy that's going to shoot you, eh?
That was the thing. He does Sylvester Stallone and he mentions Murdoch.
Yeah.
From Rambo First Blood Part 2. Yeah. And it's, what's his name? The warden is Murdoch.
The warden's named Murdoch in this movie.
No. The warden is the guy who played Murdoch in Rambo 2.
It's the same guy.
So when he says, like, Murdoch, you shot my brother or whatever, it's Murdoch is the guy who plays the warden.
That is a deep reference.
I was like, okay, that's actually pretty, like, you know.
And not to mention, like, as we said, Jim Varney was a character actor. So this is, like, what he does is impressions. So all these impressions he does is, they are hilarious.
Yeah. By the way, what is this movie rated and what was it intended for?
I mean, I saw it as like a 5 or 6 year old. Okay. I don't remember.
No, because I watched Ernest movies all the time as a kid. As a kid. I'm actually glad I rewatched it. It's been so long since I'd seen Ernest one. I think Ernest in Africa was when I was like, I'm done.
Jim Varney was like the Jim Carrey in the
80s. No, he's an amazing actor. Yeah.
I will say, though, this movie, like, there's no way this would be a kid's movie today. They're constantly putting guns in people's faces.
Yeah.
There's like there's a Confederate flag at the prison.
It is supposed to be a prisoner, so it's like,
yeah,
it's
no,
a
it makes
guy,
sense.
You know,
but today, a film executive wouldn't even risk that. They'd be like,
no, but then I like too that that guy Lyle, who is like the prisoner guy with the weird hair. He starts liking
the guy who doesn't speak until the end.
He starts like feeling bad, and he's like, no, like, and then at the like when he finally like helps. So that's the one thing. Ernest goes on this rampage. Eventually, he gets the chair.
Okay, all right.
That's another thing. They try to execute a man in this. So, I'm like, this isn't a kid's movie.
I need 10 seconds to think of this is one of the best scenes in movie history. Like if I was teaching a film class, I would show this.
No, honestly, like I was saying, like with all the people we were talking about, the Shaggy meme where Shaggy is overpowered. Ernest is
overpowered.
He is overpowered. He is like, he gets the electric chair. He lives. He gets up.
It's like a Frankenstein electric chair. Yeah. Like, this isn't even like, I don't even know if they use this in prisons or anything. This is like the most like medieval type, like, you know, contraption. So they put him in this electric chair and they build it up like it's this dark scene, like Ernest is going to die.
Yeah.
But you know he's immune to electricity.
Yeah.
So you're just waiting for it. And then he's like,
the noises he makes too, when he's going, he's like, he does it
everything metal starts going to his body, and then everybody's like, run, like all these like guards are just running to get away, and then he starts walking like
and people come up with like rifles, and he just goes like bzz, and shoots all this electricity and blows their rifles,
exploding things in the brain. He blows a hole in the prison. It's like, how many monsters are getting in?
He blows the
way he's doing, he's like striking all these poses
under his leg and stuff. And then that's when Lyle comes out and is like, hey man, but, like, he helps him out, and he's like, he's like, you're not like us, like, get out of here. It's not gonna be the same without you.
But Ernest is innocent, he doesn't belong in the jail. But after he did all that whole rampage, I find myself questioning.
He should be in jail.
I'm sure like those guys have like shrapnel damage in their hand, and like they were fried with electricity. Their heart might have stopped.
Like, I mean, he doesn't just zap a few people. He fucking annihilates that place.
He destroys the prison and blows a hole in their main gate.
Yeah.
Like, to get out.
I guess while all that's happening, evil Ernest, Mr. Nash.
Yeah.
He's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
He's so much better than Ernest. He might be a murderer. But, like, just like when he, like, changes Ernest's room to just, like, this bachelor bed.
He makes his house actually look cool.
And he's wearing, like, the robe. How many bad guys wear robes? Bison wears a robe. Nash wears a robe.
I love when Ernest gets back and he sees his apartment after Nash has, like, turned it into, like, a real apartment. Yeah. And he's like, I've been vandalized by Elvis. And it's like, because his apartment was just all this crazy Rube Goldberg machinery that like makes things happen. And then he turns it into like nice furniture, CDs and a stereo and all this stuff.
He throws the dog in the trash can. That was my favorite part. I gotta get rid of this dog. And he just puts it in the trash can.
That made me so sad when he's like, Rimshot. And he's like, who would throw out a perfectly good dog?
Rimshot is also in Ernest Scared Stupid, too.
You know what? I don't remember. I remember Ernest Scared Stupid.
I mean, I don't know if it's the same exact dog, but it's the,
it's his dog.
I remember these two in Africa, which was again where I was like, I'm done with Ernest. But yeah, preparing for this reel, I'm like, there's so many goddamn Ernest movies. I don't think I've seen half of them.
So the other really good scene, the way this movie ends, is with Ernest actually fighting Mr. Nash in the bank.
Yeah.
And this scene is done the old-fashioned way, where it's just Ernest. It's a Jim Varney and a stunt double.
Mm-hmm.
So when Jim Varney's playing Ernest, somebody else is playing the stunt double.
Yeah.
Reverse it when Jim Varney's playing Mr. Nash, you know, and they keep going back and forth. And it works. It works really well. It's like the editing is really tight. There's only one shot, I think, where you see both Jim Varneys together, where it's a really obvious blue screen.
Yeah,
that's the only
pretty bad
one.
Yeah,
yeah. But when he's like on the ceiling with the vacuum cleaner and everything,
where you can see the track, by the way, both times. Like, there's the track.
I love that part. It just made me laugh. This movie, it's a cartoon. It's a cartoon in real life.
It's a Looney Tunes. Yeah. It's a live action Looney Tunes.
You know, I was really worried about watching it. I'm like, because I used to love it. I'm like, is this one of those things that doesn't hold up? And I'm like, you know what?
It's really fun. That's how I felt too. not like, am I going to find this funny today?
Not every joke is a winner, but I'm like, no, for the most part, like, a kid would love this.
I will say,
and when he's fighting Mr. Nash, you're looking at it and you're like, okay, it was a pretty bold move to put them in the same exact outfit, because in all logic, this should be confusing to look at. But it never becomes confusing, because every time you see Jim Varney, like, with his facial expression, you know when you're looking at Mr. Nash.
When he does Nash, he, like, closes one eye.
But that's the thing, like, he just looks... That's what I'm saying is, like, he was believable as Ernest and as Nash, even though they're the same guy.
He was a good
actor. They both felt like two completely different characters.
I heard reports that he was, like, a great actor.
No, dude, he...
Like,
in this movie,
he might have done theater stuff.
This is Jim Varney, a trained professional actor.
Oh, God, well, she would hang on him as if increase of appetite had grown by what it fed on. No, what I mean, Varney.
He was so impressive the entire time. I like this movie. I can't stress enough, like, Jim Varney is a genius. Like, he's really good in this movie. Like, I saw this movie as a child, and I haven't watched it until now, but when I'm watching it, like, I was like, man, he's a comedic genius. Like, Jim Varney was no joke. Like, he, every single thing, like, you could say whatever you want, like, Ernest, he's this dumb cartoony guy. No, his physical comedy, his acting was incredible. Everything about this movie,
his facial expressions are, like, so animated.
Like, he is, like, every single thing he does, this movie was very lively. I think this movie is incredible.
I'd like to go back and watch some of the other ones. I feel like they get bad at a point.
Once you get into the late 90s, it starts getting bad. But
this might have been the last theatrical one.
No, there was because Ernest Scared Stupid I saw in the theater. That was later.
Oh, okay.
But in between, or maybe it was right before this one, it was the Christmas one was good.
Okay.
So basically, you got a Halloween one, you got a Christmas one.
Okay.
So those are good to break out for the holidays.
Yeah.
The camp one's pretty good. Especially the commercials. I mean, you can't go wrong. If you look,
I gotta check those out.
Just like YouTube all the old commercials, and they're hilarious.
Okay.
But also, one thing I wanted to say about, like, that last scene, which I think is incredible, like, the editing is amazing on that last scene, but it ends with Ernest disarming a bomb, or not disarming it, but having to take the bomb into the air. Oh, God, I got to explain. Well, basically, he gets electrocuted so much that he reaches a new level in his superpowers, which is now he can float.
He's like, polarized. There's no gravitational pull. And also, the 3 minutes and 45 seconds that was put on that bomb lasted like almost 15 minutes. Like, it was
And also, I love that whole scene. Nash is always dubbed, because like, every time he's like, oh, let's see what how they handle this thing or whatever, or like, you know, like, they're always dubbing it, kind of like Bruce Campbell in Evil Dead 2. Certain shots. So Ernest takes this bomb and he flies up into the sky like a hero, just to let it explode out in safety. And then you think Ernest is dead for a while, and then he
blows up.
He falls down and you see him alive a bit, and he just goes, I came, I saw, I got blown up. And then he falls down, and the movie ends.
Yeah.
And as a kid, I was devastated, because I was like, did he just die? Like, is he really dead now?
I thought it more of like a Looney Tunes thing.
Kind of like you expect, like, the boo.
So this is the only Ernest movie where he ambiguously dies at the end.
Do you think there were people on the edge of their seat, like with Avengers Infinity War, like, they're whale? Did Ernest make it out?
As a kid.
If YouTube existed, you would have done a video and be like, my theory on if Ernest is still alive.
If this movie was out nowadays, did Ernest die and goes to jail?
It's 10 like, reasons oh why Ernest God. Lived.
Let us know. Did Ernest die at the end?
Is Ernest dead?
Oh my God.
With all seriousness, I miss Jim Varney.
He was good.
He was really amazing.
Yeah.
And he seemed like such a kind guy, too. Like, you see him in interviews and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So.
What a legend.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Sometime we should do the Christmas and the Halloween one.
I'd be definitely down for
another
one.
I like to rewatch that.
Yeah.
Oh.
Mm. So I went to the fire department, and I talked to the fire marshal. And he said, you can have more than 3 people in a movie review. But he also said, this building is out of code because there's no sprinkler system, so they're shutting it down.
Oh.
Well, I guess let's go to the bar.
Oh, while we're there, we could talk about Roadhouse.
Oh,
sure.
Let's go.